Welcome to the Waynesburg Effect, WCTV's only political talk show, and we have a lot to dive into today. I'm Dylan Cleland. Joining me, our panelists today, Dakota Keefer, Colin Mclaughlin, and Ben Filak, making his debut here on the Waynesburg Effect. Very happy to have Ben on board. Today we're going to dive into the ISIS leader who was killed recently, Medicare for everyone. Is it an option for us as United States citizens? And also we'll check on the 2020 race, a couple of recent developments with that that we will dissect. All of that coming up today here on the Waynesburg Effect. Welcome back to the Waynesburg Effect. Let's start today's show by talking about a big move for the United States as the ISIS leader, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, was killed via a raid style last week. The United States forces using a large amount of arms and weapons to go in and fire this location up and eventually resulting in his death, confirmed by DNA that matched it. What do we think of this as a nation, and how big of a move is this for the Trump administration?
Well, as a nation, I mean, it is obviously a big victory. I don't think it's just a big victory for the nation. It's a big victory for the world, but it also obviously doesn't mean that it's over with ISIS or even close. But it's the biggest global terrorist death since Osama bin Laden in May of 2011, and that is something to be said. It's very big news. Obviously, al-Baghdadi has done a lot of terrible things going with the movement of ISIS. But ISIS is not just one person. It's not one man. It's sort of become an idea. It's a lifestyle now. And there's a lot of younger people that are now in ISIS that are training to become leaders in ISIS. And they can absolutely take place of what Baghdadi was doing. And so it's a big win. But it's far from over with ISIS, not only from a United States perspective, but also from a world perspective.
Yeah, obviously, al-Baghdadi was a horrible guy. I mean, he went out and he blew himself up. And not only that, he had two children with him in the hole that he blew himself up in. However, it's still a major victory for the United States. And it wouldn't have been possible if the Kurdish forces there in Syria didn't know of his location. That helped us track him down and able to have that two-hour raid in which they killed him. And it is a great victory for us, but unfortunately, I do agree with Dakota. The war on terrorism isn't over. ISIS probably, by now, already found a new leader. I mean, even though al-Baghdadi was the leader and the founder of ISIS, there's definitely more people there that were able to take his place, and it's still a war on terrorism. And the Trump administration needs to milk this out as much as possible, especially with the impeachment process going on right now.
Yeah, I don't think anyone's really saying this is the end of terrorism. This is just the end of one particular piece of scum who was killed by the Trump administration. Not just him. I shouldn't say just the Trump administration. The people who went in and killed him, we should all take a moment and thank them. They did an awesome job in this, especially the dog. I think his name was Conan, was his name, or her name. But the thing is that I realize with this is the Trump administration is getting attacked from all angles right now by the media, by everyone, and they finally did something that's good for everyone. We can all agree this was a good thing that this scumbag was killed. But this, people are still using this as an opportunity to attack Trump. Like the Washington Post recently, they made a headline talking about this story as they referred to al-Baghdadi as, quote, an austere religious scholar that was killed. That's insane to me that someone this terrible can be labeled as something like that by the mainstream media. So this is just the anti-Trump derangement syndrome is really coming to fruition with this situation.
Obviously, it is a big victory for the administration, and it's a big victory for America, but it still doesn't deny the fact the Kurds were the ones that helped the United States here, and it doesn't deny the fact that a little over a month ago now, the United States pulled out of Syria and abandoned the Kurds in a major time of need. And I know this was a big death for Baghdadi, but it also doesn't help the trust factor with the United States and their allies now. There's still that lack of trust that the allies will now have towards the United States just because of what they did about a month ago with the Kurds pulling out of Syria. So obviously, all the credit in the world to the soldiers and everyone involved in the mission to kill Baghdadi. Major victory there. But let's not ignore the fact that while it was a big victory, we had help from outside sources, and in particular the Kurds, and that was just someone that Donald Trump sort of abandoned all of a sudden about a month ago.
So let's take a turn with this now before we move on. You all agree that the threat of terrorism is still there after this. But where is the real threat? Is it domestic terrorism? Because we've seen that in the United States at times. Or is it this international terrorism? What is the larger threat for a U.S. citizen at this time?
Well, I think the threat for a U.S. citizen, I don't want to necessarily say it's a global threat or a domestic threat. It's just an ideology. It's an idea. And it's an idea that these people follow. It doesn't even necessarily have to be ISIS. Obviously, ISIS is probably the biggest terror organization in the world. But it's an idea that people have that we see it even across the United States for different things. People can sort of get brainwashed and do terrible things because of an idea. It's happened for years. And it will continue to happen. I don't think you can ever eliminate terrorism completely because it's not one man. It's not one organization. It's not one group. It is a mindset that these people unfortunately picked up as young children, get brainwashed into believing these things and thinking that other people are horrible and that they need to do, they need to act violently towards these other groups and other people. And I think that's where it really sits. It's not the world. It's not domesticated. It's just everyone. It's an idea and it's dangerous.
Yeah, you see it all the time now, especially with all these mass shootings here in America. The people that do it, it's all domestic, and the thing is that they share all these ideals on a website with other people that share their ideals, and they're just ranting and ranting that we see after all these mass shootings about their ideals, and everybody else is agreeing with them, and you see all these things about them wanting to attack eventually after this, in which we find it, and then it already happens.
Evil exists everywhere in the world. It's not just here. It's not just in other countries. It's not just in ISIS. It's not just when the Nazis were in the 40s. Evil will never go away, but any blow that we can make to any worldwide organization like ISIS is a good one. None of us are saying we shouldn't attack ISIS or we shouldn't go after people like this, but this will be a fight that probably never, for the rest of human history, it will never end. Evil will always exist. So this is a good victory for us, but it's just the beginning.
Okay, well, we will check in on that later on in the year. I'm sure we'll revisit that idea. But coming up next, we will talk about Medicare for everyone. Is it possible? We'll dive into that next on the Waynesburg Effect.
It's a Saturday night. You know what that means. Time to party. Sam is having a good time watching sports, drinking beer, playing Pong. Not a care in the world for Sam. Nobody at the party stopped Sam. They let him walk out the door with his keys, even though he was stumbling, having a hard time to stand up. What happened less than 10 minutes later would change Sam's life forever.
We're back on the Waynesburg Effect, on to our second topic of our episode today. Let's talk about Medicare for everyone. It's a lot of conflicting opinions. It's a very popular one that's being discussed right now. Is it possible? And even if it is, who's going to pay for it and how are we going to afford it? Ben, we'll start with you.
Medicare for all is not a good idea for America. It is not affordable under any circumstance unless we have to raise taxes for everyone. Most people in the Democratic primary right now are for Medicare for all. I do not think it is a good idea in America, as it has not done very well in other countries. I know people think it has, but it hasn't. It's a concept that will not work in a country that is set up the way we are. It should not be implemented in any way in America.
I agree with that. The cost is actually severe. And if you look at some of the plans that some of the top Democratic candidates are rolling out, Elizabeth Warren's plan will cost $50 trillion over 10 years. $50 trillion. Bernie Sanders' plan would cost, $17 trillion less, but still $33 trillion over the span of 10 years. That's astronomical and a little bit outrageous. And I think it's something that the American public does have a reason to worry about. Now, I know Medicare for All seems great, but I think there are better alternatives. And there's several alternatives that to look at, but I think one to look at would be a U.S. National Health Service. And this is something interesting that I looked into a little bit more. So around 70% of the country already has health insurance. There's just that 30% that has to use Medicaid or doesn't have any health insurance at all. And that's an issue. Now, what this would do, it would use government facilities and staff by government employees, and it would not be reimbursed-based like Medicare for All would be. So it would be a little more cost-effective, because the thing about it, it would still cost money, but you'd still be using the cost of that money for what was already going towards Medicaid and then a little bit extra. So it would not be as excessive as something like Medicare for All. That would be $50 trillion. And the thing about it is, most people want to keep the health insurance that they already have. I know, just even discussing with my parents, they never wanted to get rid of their health insurance. In fact, that was the biggest gripe with Obamacare, is that some people had to get rid of the health insurance that they had because it didn't fit the plans. So I think this would be a little bit better, because if you have health insurance, you could keep your health insurance. There's no problem with that. Or you could switch to Medicare, or you could switch to the U.S. National Health Service. But you don't have to, and most people wouldn't, because it would still provide better service, obviously, if you could pay for it. But if you can't afford to pay for it, this would be a good alternative instead of people using Medicaid or not having any at all. And I think it's something that would benefit most of the country. It would be pretty cost-effective compared to Medicare for All.
Yeah, I'll agree with Ben and Dakota as well. I don't think it's possible for the United States to have Medicare for All, but I took a more in-depth look at what exactly Medicare for All is, because I feel like voters don't actually know what it is. The one that I looked at is single-payer Medicare for All, in which you have three main things. That is universal coverage, single-payer, obviously, and then abolishing private insurance here in the United States. A lot of the countries here that have that is France, Israel, and Canada, and you can't compare the United States to those three. Many healthcare experts say that single-payer is the most effective way to deliver Medicare for All to the greatest number of people, and obviously the United States has that. And according to ProPublica.org, there's only two Democrats that actually support Medicare for All in its entirety, as I mentioned, with universal coverage, single payer, and abolishing private insurance. Those two is Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders. Everybody else supports different types of it. Yang supports both universal coverage and single payer, but doesn't support abolishing private insurance. Booker, Buttigieg, Harris, and Castro only support universal insurance, and then Klobuchar and Biden support universal coverage, but it's not actually on their platform.
So, according to Healthline, these numbers are 27.5 million people in the United States do not have health care coverage, and 45% of them say it's because they cannot afford it. So, if this is not going to work, according to what your thoughts are, personally, it would be great. I mean, anything like that would be great if we could get that to work in our country, but I just don't see it happening, and so I don't think it's worth making that push for. Something that you pointed out, it's a far left group that is really pushing for this in Sanders and Warren, but they also happen to be two of the three front runners right now on the Democratic side. So with that in mind, is this just another, do you think it's just another push to try to get people, to try to get votes?
I think, personally, I think it is. I think it's something to try and get votes from the younger people that love the idea of free Medicare for everyone. And it would be great. I'm not going to say that it wouldn't be great if we could possibly do Medicare for All, but it's just not feasible with the amount of money that it would cost. And both of the plans from Warren and Sanders, upwards of $30 to $40 trillion. So it would not be possible. That's why I like the things that someone like a Pete Buttigieg says. He says he wants to let the public know what they're actually paying for, what they are doing, and that's why he doesn't think that Medicare for All would be really feasible. He's not someone that's completely for Medicare for All. In fact, he doesn't think it will necessarily work. He looks at other plans. Even someone like Joe Biden isn't completely for Medicare for All, because you have to have some understanding, especially if you're going to go to a general election, if you want to win the Democratic primaries and then go to a general election against Donald Trump. You're going to have to be a little bit transverse and talk to the American public and understand and let them understand where their money's going to go for. Because someone has to pay for it, and it would end up coming out of taxpayers' wallets.
I disagree that it would be good to have Medicare for All in general. I want everyone to have health care, but I do not want it to come from the government. I think that we need to treat it more like a good and not a right that is given to people. The reason is, if you declare something a right and the government takes control of it or does anything to do with it, it eliminates all incentive to improve it. if you take any sort of thing that the government has touched in the last 20 years, it's fallen apart, or at least it's done terribly. Do you want the people who run the DMV to take control of your health care? The answer is probably no. Have you ever been to the DMV? It's terrible. The issue is, whenever you declare something a right, whenever you say it's everyone deserves it, the government takes control, that eliminates all private incentive to improve it. The U.S. is actually the first, we're first in the world in new vaccines, new cures, research, just general research in the medical field. So the closer we get to declaring that something's a right, like Medicare, the closer we are going to get to complete government takeover of it, and that's what I'm afraid of.
But that's why I think something like a U.S. National Health Service would be better than Medicare for All, because you could still keep the health insurance that you already have, that you pay for, that you love. I know a lot of people love the health insurance they already have, and they would not want to give it up. They'd be willing to pay that extra money for it. So then you would have something like, well, if you can't afford it, then you're going to have to go to a government facility that can provide it for you. Obviously, it's not going to be as ideal or as good as something that you pay for. But if you can't afford it, then it's something that would be a necessity and you'd have to live with. And then maybe eventually you could afford it and go and pay for your own health insurance. That's why I think a U.S. National Health Service, just a completely, it's a better system that I don't think a lot of people talk about, and I really don't know why. I think if someone could come up with a plan for that and discuss it, it would actually meet people's ears a lot better than Medicare for All, because obviously you hear Medicare for All, everyone instantly thinks, well, I'm going to have to pay for that. And obviously there will be some form of payment towards a health service, but it would already be sort of paid for with what was going towards Medicaid anyways.
Well, unfortunately, that's all the time we have for Medicare for All. We'll see if this has an effect on the election, which we're going to talk about next on the Waynesburg Effect. We are officially a year out as of the other day, which was Election Day 2019. Fast forward a year, we'll be ready to vote for another president. We'll talk about that on the Democratic side when we come back. It is November, which means we are exactly a year out from electing a new president or keeping the incumbent who will be President Donald Trump, most likely the Republican nominee, back in office. So, gentlemen, let's first start by a development that came out last week. Beto O'Rourke removed himself from the Democratic race. Let's do a little bit of like a lightning round with this. Why did his campaign flop? And give me one flaw.
I feel like it was just simply because there were too many people in the race. I mean, there were, 20 Democratic presidential nominees to start, and I feel like since he was basically a nobody compared to a lot of the top runners, he had no choice but to drop.
I agree. There's way too many people in the race, but something else, I think Beto focused too much. He's focused a lot on gun control, and that was most of his campaign. He even went to there was a point where he went to like a gun shop and questioned gun owners and things like that. And I think that's not ideal for what you need to do. You need to focus on a wider aspect of things and not just a central focus. And that's sort of where he flopped at.
I think Beto tried to stand out too much by being more radical than everyone else on the Democratic platform, and that scared people away. Like he said that credit card companies should be liable for purchases made through them for firearms, and that kind of thing is way too radical to even make it on a Democratic stage.
Okay, so let's shift now into the actual conversation about the ones that are left, and there's a lot. This field does need to narrow down. But the three front runners right now, Joe Biden, Bernie Sanders, and Elizabeth Warren, two of the three share very similar ideas, very similar platforms. How's that going to affect the others in this top three or four, depending on who you talk to, front runners?
Well, I think the two out of the three that are very similar would be Warren and Sanders. And for Sanders, I think something that would already be a downfall to him would be something that just happened not long ago when he had a heart attack. And obviously, Warren's not a young lady. She's 71, I believe, almost 72. But, Sanders, a little bit older than that, nearing 80, has the heart issues now. It's something to be concerned with, and they have similar ideals and similar views. Mentioned earlier about Medicare for All, they're both highly for that. So I think that's something that could harm Sanders because of the health issues and because he's so similar to Warren. She will probably, in the end, pull ahead of Sanders.
Yeah, I'll agree that it's probably going to be Warren over Sanders, but I've been saying it since last year. I feel as if the Democrats truly want to have a chance at beating Donald Trump, they need Joe Biden to be the nominee, and that's because he's the most moderate. That's the only way to take votes away from Donald Trump here to make sure that he doesn't get four more years in the office, is have that moderate guy in Joe Biden to go up against him. I know he can't talk that well, but if Joe Biden is the guy, you can get votes against Donald Trump. He can continue to attack him. And if it's Sanders or Warren, Trump's going to eat him alive because he always comes up with nicknames for people. He knows how to attack people. That's his biggest thing, and that's how he's going to beat those two.
Yeah, I think it's a three-way race right now, and because Warren and Bernie are so close, until probably Bernie will drop out first, I think. And then all his supporters, I think, are going to go to Warren. There's very little chance they're going to go to Biden. So I honestly think Warren's going to come out on top at the end. And like you said, I think Trump will demolish her.
Well, I think that's where the issue or the decision's really going to lie. I think it's going to come down to, you know, a lot of Bernie's supporters might go to Warren, but what's Bernie going to do? How does he feel? Obviously, he shares a similar platform with Warren, but does he truly believe that she can do it over, maybe Joe Biden? Let's talk about a couple of the younger candidates. Is there anyone that could make a late push? You know, you have Mayor Pete Buttigieg, who has impressed a lot of people. Cory Booker has been in politics for a while, and he's also been impressive, but none of the younger men or women have really stood out.
I think it's absolutely the only one out of them that stands out is Mayor Pete. I don't think Booker has a prayer. But Mayor Pete, first off, he's a fantastic public speaker. And I don't think he would be the one out of, I think even the top three, that wouldn't get rattled by Donald Trump coming at him. In fact, Mayor Pete would probably have responses for him right away. He's a very good at interviews, very good in a debate setting. And he's also not nearly as radical as the rest of the party really is. I know Joe Biden's not radical himself, but also he has trouble speaking. He's older. Mayor Pete's someone that's younger, a fresher face, and he can also speak very well. I think he would be able to combat Donald Trump very well. Unfortunately, I don't think he'll end up winning the primaries, but he's someone that I believe he's pulling ahead closer and closer in the caucuses and in the polls, and he's one of the only ones outside of the top three that I think could have a chance at doing anything.
I think that he would be a fantastic VP for whoever the Democratic nominee is. He's exactly what they need, someone who can articulate arguments well against, obviously, Trump. Trump is kind of the same way as Biden. He's not the best debater or speaker. He never has a problem conveying what he thinks in a public setting. So I think Buttigieg would be a perfect VP for, I think Warren's going to win the nomination. So I think a Warren-Buttigieg ticket is something that's going to happen in the future.
Yeah, I'll agree. I think Mayor Pete definitely will last the longest here this year in the presidential nominee race in that young group of faces, especially as Dakota said, because he's very well at public speaking. I feel like he's going to last the longest. But another guy that I think could also last is Yang. I feel like he's a really good speaker as well. And I feel like they're going to be two people that are going to last a while here down the road. Maybe not this year, but we're going to see their name a lot here in the upcoming years in these races.
Okay, let's real quick, we have about a minute left. Let's circle back to where we started with Beto O'Rourke. Where do people like him go from here? He came out and said he was going to back a nominee but didn't name one. Where do you see some of these candidates that will eventually drop out going and putting their support?
I think they'll put the support who they think would have the best chance at defeating Donald Trump. And I think a lot of them will start to support Joe Biden because I think Joe Biden has the best chance of defeating Donald Trump. I don't think Elizabeth Warren will defeat Donald Trump. I think he would eat her alive on a stage. He would probably eat Joe Biden alive on a stage a little bit more. But let's be real. The Pocahontas thing with Elizabeth Warren, you know, with Trump's personality, he would bring that up nonstop. So that's something that I think the candidates would look at. I think they'd push towards Biden.
Yeah, we hear it all the time in Professor Krause's classes. He says, with Hillary Clinton from the previous election, what do you think of when you hear Hillary? Crooked, because of Donald Trump. If it's Warren, that's what you're going to hear. What do you think of Elizabeth Warren? Pocahontas. If it's Biden, I don't think he's going to have something like that against him for Donald Trump to attack him with. So that's what it's going to be, I feel like. And these guys need to step up, say who they support. And they're probably going to say that for somebody that they feel as if, what Ben said, they can have for a vice presidency.
Yeah, I'm thinking same thing with these guys. Joe Biden will be the one that most of them support.
Okay, we'll see what happens as things will continue to rapidly develop over the coming months for sure. When we come back, we will conclude today's show with our famous and very opinionated commentary segment. We'll come back for that next on the Waynesburg Effect.
Have you ever been to the Everly Library? If not, you should, because it's great. They have books of all different genres, history, biography, fiction, try The Evolution of Life, Life of Pi, or Jurassic Park. So what if books aren't your thing? Try movies like Frozen or TV shows like Lost. Books and DVDs aren't the only thing though. Take a trip to the second floor. Welcome to the Writing Center. These tutors will tell you everything you need to know about writing a paper, and they'll help revise your essays. Now let's head back down. Behold, the Knox Learning Center. Need to print something out 5 minutes before your next class because you procrastinated? No problem. You can also print off pictures of dogs. Because, well, you can. So grab your homework, laptop, and textbook, and study diligently. Bring your lunch, too. Actually, you can't. That's illegal. Now you know the Everly Library. Stop by anytime. Seriously, it's open all week.
We are back on the Waynesburg Effect. It's time to wrap up today's program with our commentary segment. We'll start on the end and work down to myself. Ben, what do you have for us?
Well, last Sunday night, the Baltimore Ravens played the New England Patriots in a game that was probably one of the most viewed games in the country in the history of this league. they defeated them, ending the Patriots' attempt at a perfect season. And this is a big win for the Ravens, big win for the AFC. Now the AFC is broken wide open. And whether Republican or Democrat, we can all agree on one thing, is we hate the Patriots. So
I'll agree with that. Yeah, I definitely hate the New England Patriots, even though I have a great respect for Bill Belichick and Tom Brady. But I'm going to stick with football. I'm going to go after the Washington Redskins here. A big thing going on right now with Trent Williams. According to him, he had a cancer spot in his near his brain, and the Redskins medical officials said that he was cleared to play. He was okay. So he had a holdout. Now he's back with the team. He's not playing because he didn't clear his physical, but there's just a lot going on with them. And hopefully, my biggest thing, this goes after Bruce Allen and Dan Snyder, the president of the team as well as the owner of the team. The Redskins fans have hated them for so long, and hopefully this is the final straw to get them out.
We're going to go 3 for 3 on football here. I'm going to go with Mike Tomlin, and what I'm going about with him is the fact that I believe he is incredibly underappreciated. He lost his starting Hall of Fame quarterback in Ben Roethlisberger. He's went through a number of running back issues. The wide receiver core is not very good. The schedule has been incredibly difficult, and he somehow has this team at 4-4 through playing the 49ers, the Seahawks, playing the Patriots. They lost, obviously. That usually happens. But 4-4 through this schedule, even having to go with Duck Hodges at one point and winning a game. So I think Mike Tomlin's incredibly underappreciated. He's sort of taking control of the defensive side of things with the Steelers, and I think they've been thriving in that aspect. And I think it's something the Pittsburgh fans need to understand, that he is a really good coach, and he needs to be appreciated more than he is.
Well, here at WCTV, we strive as student journalists and student future aspiring broadcasters to do the best that we can to bring you news, sports, politics, religion on the journey, whatever show it might be that you watch. And we all work very hard, and we try to do it as fair and as unbiased as possible, especially on this show. And so anytime we're recognized for that, we're very humbled and very appreciative. Next to me right here is a 2019 Communicator Award for the Waynesburg Effect. We recently received this award, and as I said, we're very humbled by that. But it cannot be done without the work of everybody here in the Department of Communication and WCTV, from our general manager, Paul Zalikar, down to the producers, such as our producer for this show, Mitch Montani, and the crew as well. It's really a team effort. You know, we get to sit up here and look good in the HD this year, which is really nice, but it cannot be done with everyone from the top to the bottom. So I want to personally say thank you to everyone, a part of this department, a part of WCTV, and on behalf of these guys, our producers, our people in the back, thank you for tuning in and helping us be as successful as we are. That is all with the time we have for the Waynesburg Effect today. Make sure you tune in next time for more political talk here on WCTV's only political talk show.
This has been a production of Waynesburg Community Television.